Marava Gunja Vihari. Kapijana Malapa Girivardhari Jaya Kapijana Malapa Swami Prabhupada ki
yeah.
Jai, Anant Koti Vaishnavind ki
yeah.
Jai, Iskon Samstap Kacharya, Srila Prabhupada ki jai,
yeah.
Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur ki
yeah.
Pemsakuhu Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Dhan, Shri Advaita Gadadha, Shri Vasana Gopavinda ki
yeah.
Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopi Gopinath Samakund Radha Kund Giri Govardhan Ki
Jai
Shri Vrindavanam Ki Jai
yeah.
Shri Mayapur Navadviptam ki, Shri Jagannath Puridam ki, Gangamaya ki, Jamunamaya ki, Tulsi Devi ki, Bhakti Devi ki, Sankirtan Yajna ki, Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda ki. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. Guru Pinandi Yuri Guru. Jai Jai Sri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda.
Jai Jai Sri Chaitanya
Jai Nityananda. Jai Dvaita Chandra Jai Gaur Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai Dvaita Chandra Jai
Gaur Bhakta Vrinda. Jai Jai Sri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda.
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 Jai Advaita Chandra Jai Gaur Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai Advaita Chandra Jai Gaur Bhakta Vrinda.
So we're starting today with text 188. I think that's the one on the board, right?
Yes.
Manya Leela, chapter 19. Pancharasa stai.
Pancharasa stai.
Vyapirahe bhaktamane.
Yapirahe bhaktamane.
Saptaguna.
Saptaguna.
Agantuka pai karane.
Agantuka pai karane.
Pancharasa stai vyapirahe bhaktamane.
Pancharasa stai vyapirahe bhaktamane.
Sapta guna agantuka pai karane.
Sapta guna agantuka pai karane.
Please chant.
Pancharasa stai vyapi raha bhaktamane.
Pancharasa stai vyapi raha bhaktamane.
Sapta guna agantuka pai karane.
Sapta guna agantuka pai karane.
Five, direct. transcendental mellows.
500 transcendental mellows.
Stayi.
Stayi.
Permanently existing.
Permanently existing.
Vyapi.
Vyapi.
Expanded.
Expanded.
Rahe.
Rahe.
Remain situated.
Remain situated.
Bhaktamani.
Bhaktamani.
In the heart of a devotee.
In the heart of a devotee.
Saptaguna.
Saptaguna.
Seven indirect mellows.
Seven indirect mellows.
Agantuka.
Agantuka.
Accidental.
Accidental.
Paiye.
Paiye.
Appearing. Karane.
Karane.
Under certain conditions.
Under certain conditions.
Translation. The five direct transcendental mellows of devotional service are permanently situated in the heart of the devotee, whereas the seven indirect emotions appear suddenly under certain conditions and appear more powerful. Please repeat. The five direct transcendental mellows of devotional service. Are permanently situated in the heart of the devotee.
Are permanently situated in the heart of the devotee.
Whereas the seven indirect emotions,
appear suddenly
under certain conditions,
and appear more powerful.
There's no purport. Next verse. Shantabhakta Navayogendra Sanakadi Ar Dasya Bhava Bhakta Sarvatra Sevaka Apara. Examples of Shantabhaktas, the neutral devotees, are the nine Yogendras and the four Kumaras. Examples of devotees in Dasya Bhakti are innumerable, for such devotees exist everywhere. The nine saintly Yogendras are named Kavi, Havi, Antariksha, Prabuddha, Pipalayana, Avirhotra, Dravida, or Drumala, Chamasa, and Karabhajan. The four Kumaras are Sanak, Sanandana, Sanat Kumar, and Sanatana. The servant devotees in Gokula are Raktak, Chitraka, Patrak, and so on. In Dwarka there are servants like Daruka, and in the Lord's pastimes in the material world there are servants like Hanuman. Today is the appearance anniversary of Hanuman. Om Ganatavarambasya Ganajana Shalakaya Chakrasramiri Tamina Tasmai Shri Kurve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Vado Vishnu Stapitam Menu Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Sva Patantikam Vandeyam Shri Guru Shri Uttapada Kamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavam Shcha Shri Rupam Sagrajam Sagana Nagana tanvitam tam sjimam sabetam samadhutam prajana sahitam krishna chaitanya devam shri radha krishna padam sahagana lalita shri vishakam vitam shcha he krishna karuna sindhu dina bandhu jagapate upesha Gopika kanta radha kanta namostu te tapta kanchana gaurangi radhe vrindavaneshwari vrishabhanusute devi pranamami haripriye mantra-gopata-rubhyascha kripa-sindhu-bhyevacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavibhyo namo nama Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasari Guru Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Pancha Rasa Stahi Vyapirahe Bhaktamane Saptaguna Agantuka Parikarne. So Lord Chaitanya is instructing Srila Rupa Goswami. And this is a topic that we call the mellows or the rasas. Pancharas, the five direct mellows. There's bhakti, there's prema, there's ras, rasa, bhakti, prema, rasa. There's only one verse in the Chaitanya Charitamrita that mentions these three words together. It's near the end of the Adi Lila, Bhakti Prema Rasa. But these are the nectar words, you could say. The Chaitanya Charitamrita is full of nectar about the feelings or the emotions of Lord Chaitanya and how he distributes the nectar with the help of his associates Panchatattva. So when we study Chaitanya Charitamrita, when we have these classes on the weekend, we sometimes get into the prema or the bhakti or the rasas. Lord Chaitanya had external reasons for appearing in the world. He wanted to spread the holy names, and he had his internal reasons, which were to relish the prema or the rasas, especially the rasa of conjugal love. There was a devotee described in the beginning of this chapter who was a very nice devotee from Bihar. I haven't been to Bihar, but I've met devotees in India who are from Bihar. We have the names of deities that use this Bihar word, part of this word, like Rasa Bihari. So the Bihar state is there. And there was one devotee from that area who met Lord Chaitanya. He's described in the beginning of chapter 19. His name was Raghupati. And he was such a scholar, he could write nice verses. And when he met Lord Chaitanya, Lord Chaitanya heard that he was an author, and so he said, please recite some of these verses to me. So I'll read one. Kamprati means, this is not text 98, Kamprati means unto whom, Kamprati, Katayatam, to speak. And next word, ishe, am I able? Samprati, now. He's asking a question, to whom can I speak? Who will believe me? Ka va pratitim. When I say, who will believe me when I say that Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is hunting the gopis in the bushes by the banks of the river Jamuna? In this way, the Lord demonstrates his pastimes. Indeed, when the Victorians in England heard from their people in India, the Sanskritists, there were some scholars and religionists who went to India from England, and when they became acquainted with the Srimad Bhagavatam and learned that Krishna had many gopi girlfriends or many wives, the Victorians were shocked. How can this be God? This is so contrary to morality. So the B.R. Brahman is expressing this kind of shock. Who will believe me? To whom can I speak? Who will believe me if I say that Krishna is hunting the gopis? But when he said this to Lord Chaitanya, Lord Chaitanya became absorbed in the ecstatic prema, the ecstatic love. And it's described that his body and mind kind of just slackened. He wasn't so much on the bodily or mental platform at all. He kind of gave up his attention on that level. But his transcendental consciousness was fully absorbed in these ideas and moods of the love of Krishna for the gopis. So Srila Prabhupada talks about that. He says that when our bodies and minds are always engaged in material activities, you know, we're eating and we're sleeping, we may be householders, so we have household life going on, new babies are born. I was talking to a friend yesterday. He brought his 2-year-old to the temple and he informed me, now my wife is pregnant, so number 2 is coming. So, mating and defending, eating, sleeping, mating and defending, that means material activities, but these things can be dovetailed, of course, we're not criticizing, but Prabhupada's saying, when our bodies and minds are always engaged in material activities, when they're activated on the spiritual platform, they slacken on the material platform. So you can activate the body and mind on the spiritual platform, as even the grihasthas do. And then those material activities are less. You know, I mean, if you follow the regulative principles, then you're not very active on the material platform. But on the spiritual platform, you're active to have nice children. But I wanted to refer to another verse that's similar in the Antya-lila. It reads like this: simply by chanting the holy name of Lord Krishna, one can be freed from all undesirable habits. This is the means of awakening all good fortune and initiating the flow of waves of love for Krishna. So I'll repeat that so that we can absorb it a little bit. I don't want to... Jaya Sisi, Rana Landanishvara, Jagannath Paladev, Subhadra, Shkonatai. So there are two effects of chanting. One is that it frees us from undesirable habits. Our body and mind aren't active on the material platform if we're engaged in chanting our rounds nicely or dancing and chanting in kirtan. We're automatically freed from activities on the material platform if we're doing our japa or doing kirtan. But then also, it's the means of awakening all good fortune and initiating the flow of waves of love for Krishna. So this is the topic of today's verse, actually. These rasas that are being described, the five primary rasas, they're ways in which the devotees are expressing their love for Krishna. For us, we're on the sadhana stage. We're not yet liberated souls engaged in these five primary rasas, like those devotees who act in Krishna's pastimes. But that's our goal. We have that tendency to take up, someday, take up one of these relationships with Krishna. That's our understanding. Someday, I'll be in my svarup and I'll have a ras with Krishna. But in the meantime, just by chanting Hare Krishna, I'm moving in that direction. I'm starting these waves of love for Krishna flowing. So this was the main concern of Lord Chaitanya. He was absorbed in this consciousness. Where are those waves of love of Krishna? What are those rasas? He's teaching Rupa Goswami. What are those rasas? Five primary rasas. You'll find devotees who have these rasas, and he says they're sthayi, they're permanently existing in the devotees' hearts. They're expanded in the devotees' hearts. The devotees remain situated in these rasas. So this is a description of the heart of the devotee in one of the five rasas. And Lord Chaitanya is taking a lot of pleasure in this, either when he's hearing from his devotee from Bihar, Raghupati. Raghupati is describing this in his own verses that he wrote. And now he's teaching in this section later in the chapter. He's teaching Srila Rupa Goswami about this. So it says that the bad habits, the undesirable habits, we can be freed from by chanting. It's easy to say no to something undesirable if you have a much bigger yes, you know, to affirm. If you have something bigger to affirm, like I'll develop my eternal identity, that's a much bigger affirmative. And that's what keeps us convinced that, you know, we should give up the material activities and the undesirable habits. We're going to benefit immensely, you know, more than we'll benefit eternally if we just engage in undesirable habits. Maybe we'll get some fruitive gain, but it's temporary. So we know that we don't want that as much as we want this much bigger eternal love for Krishna. So what we're reading is actually a description of how Srila Rupa Goswami becomes empowered by the Lord. He's instructed for 10 days, and in this way he's becoming empowered by Lord Chaitanya, by the personal association and instruction of Lord Chaitanya. He's becoming empowered to write books. And this was known to other devotees. You've heard of Kavi Karnapur. He was a devotee who wrote poetry and dramas. And he glorified Rupa Goswami for having received instruction from Lord Chaitanya, receiving the empowerment from Lord Chaitanya to do all this. And Srila Prabhupada made the point, when this is discussed, that it's not just this one acharya, Rupa Goswami, but other acharyas also become empowered. He describes that one becomes invested with the shakti, Krishna shakti. Then he becomes empowered to spread Krishna consciousness. So he said this happened to other acharyas too. And he didn't say like me, he didn't say other acharyas like me, but we can say that. That Srila Prabhupada became empowered to write books and spread Krishna consciousness because he was so much following the order of his spiritual master, and he was clear, he cleared everything else out, cleared everything away that except for, you know, this service that he wanted to do for his spiritual master. And he received the mercy of Lord Chaitanya. The flowers get a lot of attention when they go around. Were you following the points at the same time?
I missed that last point.
Yeah, I thought so. I better repeat. Not only Rupa Goswami was empowered by Lord Chaitanya, but Srila Prabhupada also became empowered to write books and preach Krishna consciousness. In the case of Rupa Goswami, he was lifted up by Lord Chaitanya. He had apparently fallen. He was originally from a Brahmin's family. But when the family moved to West Bengal, Rupa and Sanatan took up occupations with the Muslim rulers. And by that association, they were considered by the other Brahmins to be now outcasts or polluted. So Rupa Goswami felt that way. He felt that he had really messed up. And he said that to Vallabha Bhattacharya. When Vallabha Bhattacharya met Lord Chaitanya, he came forward to greet Rupa Goswami. And Rupa Goswami actually went away from him. He didn't say, well, yes, hi, how are you? You know, like, that's how we do it, you know, we say, shake hands and say hello. But in the Vaishnava way, Rupa Goswami avoided meeting Vallabhacharya in that way, like an equal party, and saying, oh, my dear Vallabhacharya, how are you? I'm Rupa Goswami. He went away and he said, please don't touch me. I'm an untouchable person. I'm very much a low-class person, sinful person, he said. And he said to Vallabha, Lord Chaitanya observed this, and he said to Vallabha Bhattacharya, you're actually, you know, a Brahmin, a follower of Vedic principles, and you perform sacrifices. But this Rupa Goswami, Lord Chaitanya said, this Rupa Goswami, he belongs to a very low class. And you are actually a member of the aristocracy. So while speaking like that to Vallabha Bhattacharya, Lord Chaitanya actually didn't mean that. he was giving the opposite hint. He was hinting to Vallabha Bhattacharya, don't think Rupa Goswami is low caste. Don't think he's sinful. Because now he's engaged in chanting Hare Krishna. And Vallabha Bhattacharya was able to pick up on the hint because he saw that Rupa Goswami and his younger brother were chanting Hare Krishna constantly. And so he said, how can it be that they're fallen? It can't be that they're low caste because they're engaged in chanting the names of the Lord. And he quoted a verse to substantiate the point of view. Lord Kapila's teaching, Aho Bhata Sva Pacha To Garyan. How glorious are persons who chant, even if one was a dog eater. And he takes to Krishna consciousness, a dog eater. If he takes up the chanting, he's as glorious or more glorious than the Brahmins who perform sacrifice. I don't know if you've ever met dog eaters. Yes? In Brazil they have?
No, here in London.
In London?
Chinatown.
Where?
Chinatown.
Huh?
Chinatown.
In Chinatown, exactly, yeah. I met them in China. When I was shopping, I was in China for a while, a year or two, and when we would shop for things to cook at the market, we would see the dog, the dead dog, strung up, you know, in the shop, and we would avert our eyes, you know, and then we would look down and we would see the pail. There was a pail of water with live snakes in it, so you could have snake soup if you wanted that instead. So these persons, even the dog eaters, they can take up the chanting and become as glorious as the Brahmins. That's what Kapila taught and Vallabhacharya recited this verse. And he pleased Lord Chaitanya by saying this. Lord Chaitanya said, it's very good that you're quoting Shastra to support the point that devotional service is transcendental to any caste or social position. It purifies one and it frees one from one's caste position. So you can't neglect a person who's chanting by saying, well, he comes from a family that was eating meat. Srila Prabhupada faced the criticism from certain Brahmins in India. Oh, your disciples, they used to eat meat. They were low caste meat eaters. We can't accept them. So they took some pride in their, you know, vegetarianism and their family status as Brahmins. But Lord Chaitanya came to create a revolution against that caste Brahmanism. He introduced the chanting, and that puts people on the transcendental platform. So the caste doesn't count. What becomes important then is the transcendental status that he's describing here to Rupa Goswami. These things become important. What is the rasa of a devotee? What is the heart of a devotee? How does a devotee become situated in giving love to Krishna? We have the examples of the devotees who perform pastimes with Krishna. They have these rasas permanently existing in their hearts. And we're aspiring as learners or sadhakas, we're aspiring to understand and become elevated to these rasas. I'll stop here. Any questions?
Thank you. Hare Krishna. Thank you for your lecture. I was just wondering if you could explain this word rasa, what does that mean exactly? And if we know that there are many rasas, why there are so many rasas and why we have, is this mood? Is it mean mood?
Yeah, you could say that. There's no real English word for it, so Prabhupada used the word mellow.
Mellow.
It indicates a state of the heart or a mood of loving relationship with Krishna. But it's also originally, Rupa Goswami used the word, and he also based this on a work of drama. In the dramas, you know, you find descriptions of people's relationships with each other. So that we see, you know, these relationships: parenthood, servitude, friendship, and conjugal love. But Rupa Goswami pointed out that we see these in the world because they're originally in the spiritual world, and he dramatized the spiritual world. Krishna's pastimes are sometimes compared to a dramatic performance, and the devotees are playing roles. It said they're playing the roles of parents and friends and lovers and servants. So a special word is there, rasa is there, because it's not a material activity, it's not a material affair, it's not something that's influenced by the modes of nature.
Because why I'm asking, because rasa in my language, in Lithuanian, which is very close to Sanskrit as well, it means, I don't know the English word for this, but it is this thing, is like a drop of water which comes on the grass in the morning.
Dew.
Yeah. So this, it means rasa. So I was wondering if it has any.
No, it's not like that.
Thank you.
Rasa in Lithuanian means do, huh? I don't know the Sanskrit root word. You know, I'm not a Sanskritist, so I can't explain it more. But yes, in Dimitri.
In this verse 188, it is said that the five direct transcendental mellows or devotional service are permanently situated in the heart of the devotee. I was just wondering if you could comment on this somehow.
Yes, I think I said a couple of times in the discussion that the devotees who are with Krishna have this, what is permanent, this feeling, it's a feeling of love in the heart, and the eternally liberated devotees who are in the rasas, that's eternally there for them. That's what it means. Lord Chaitanya's teaching Rupa Goswami about the eternal associates of the Lord, so they have that rasa permanently existing.
So all five of them permanently exist?
No, it doesn't mean all five in one devotee. When you read it, I know you can misread the verse. These five are existing in the heart of a devotee. And it just says a devotee. So you might think all five in one devotee. That's misreading the English. It means it's to be understood all five of these are existing in a devotee. You know, one has one and one has another and one has another one and one has another one. But the wording is, all of these are permanently existing in a devotee. So it doesn't mean all five in one. Okay?
So is it a wrong translation or something?
No, it's not the translation's fine. It's just the English might confuse you if you're not used to English. The five mellows are permanently situated in the heart of the devotee, and the word the devotee is singular. You could say the devotees if you wanted. These five direct mellows are situated permanently in the hearts of the devotees. You could translate it like that. But when you translate it with the singular, in the heart of the devotee, it means one has one rasa, one has another rasa. Editorial consideration. Yep. Indirect seven?
Yeah, it says the seven indirect emotions appear suddenly.
Appear suddenly under certain conditions.
Yeah, I mean, does that mean that all living entities are in the five direct rasas with Krishna? Does it mean that?
Well, it's speaking about those who are in the five primary rasas. And it says that sometimes these seven indirect rasas suddenly appear and act powerfully, more powerful than the five. So that's occasional. That's occasional. But other living entities like Kamsa, who are not in one of these five rasas but are in Krishna's pastimes, they're more influenced by the seven indirect rasas. That's clear, right? So your question is?
Are all living entities, it says the seven indirect emotions appear. You see, I'm confused about this word appear. It implies that all these indirect emotions are not permanent, and that all devotees, all living entities have a direct transcendental rasa with the five, are situated in the five direct transcendental rasas with Krishna.
No, but I mean, well, I'm not sure what you're saying. There are devotees who are in the five rasas, and you're saying all living entities are in the five rasas. Right?
I'm saying my limited understanding of that verse, it sort of says
so
that.
We can say that any devotee of Krishna in Krishna's pastimes, he's in one of the five rasas. Okay, that's all right. And then?
What about, like, I mean, for example, someone like Bhishma Dev?
Yeah.
I mean,
he's in the heroic rasa mostly.
But
also a servant of Krishna.
Okay, I understand.
You could say, maybe it's servitude. And
yeah, I understand. So basically, Bhishma Dev is in Dasya Rasa, and then this indirect rasa of heroism, chivalry appears. Okay.
Yeah, Rupa Goswami gives, many examples, many chapters of examples of how these rasas operate. So he cites particular examples from the Bhagavatam.
Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Ram. Okay, we'll stop there. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.
Thank you very much, Tatvi Prabhu. I would love to read some scores, but is that all?
Did you like
Okay, so we will read some Sankirtan scores from yesterday in Radha's boutique. Yesterday we distributed 3 books and collected total of 200.24 Lakshmi points. Hare Krishna. And in Govinda's restaurant, we distributed prasadam to at least 251 paid customer for a total of 2,396.91 Lakshmi points. Hare Krishna, Hare Go. Okay, that's all score-wise. And before we say a prayer, to ask who wants to serve prasadam on ladies' side. Thank you. And on men's side? Thank you. And as a couple of people to help cleaning afterwards. Just one. Thank you very much. Okay, so we will say a prayer. Dear Shishi Radha Londonishvara, Jagannath Baladev and Subhadra, Shishi Gorni Tai, and Giri Govardhan, we offer our most respectful obeisances unto you. In a mood of deep gratitude and appreciation, we request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, if you so desire, we wish to erect a holy place of your transcendental pastimes that will attract unlimited souls to your service and fulfill the vision of your pure devotee Srila Prabhupada for London. Please enable us to cooperate together in order to satisfy you in this way. We, your surrendered servants, humbly beg. New temple for the Lordship's key. Jai. Prasadam chain. Jai.